Donnie Seymour.
Good old Donnie.
Always fashionably late.
There he is.
Hey, sorry, mate.
That's okay, mate. Just let me know.
Yeah.
Okay. We're just about to get started.
Cool. Perfect.
We're talking FMS avatars, so scores that you'll most frequently see.
Yep.
And we're just going to spend probably the first 20 or 30 minutes going through this kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're going to move on to basics of barbell training, which is the topic of next week's lectures. So, let's start here. Three hurdle step, two, three. That should actually all be one. Just a little bit of formatting while we're here. Or not. So we've got a 3-3, 2-3, 3-2, 3-3. So just while I'm doing this, guys, just have to think about what type of person you're looking at here. So first question goes, is this a male or a female?
Female.
More than likely, right? Well, it's not guaranteed, but yeah, it's definitely more than likely a female. Are we dealing with someone who's floppy or stiff? They're floppy, aren't they? So they tend to score well in their mobility biased patterns, and they score poorly in their stability biased patterns, and their strength is, we'd probably call it poor.
Yep.
What else have we got going on here? What else of interest? What are the flags? What draws your attention first? Rotor stability is shocking. Trunk stability is shocking.
Got
impingement problems, on the shoulder.
How would they get a 3 and still have impingement? Wouldn't you not have done the test of it?
They'd probably have some sort of scapular ringing or something going on.
And in my experience, actually, and this took me just figuring out on my own, the people that most frequently score positive on their impingement clearing test are people that are hypermobile, as opposed to people that are stiff.
But shouldn't you not do the test if they fail it, per se?
Yeah, and again, it comes down to a little bit of a personal preference thing.
Yeah.
like I said, the FMS calls for clearing tests to be performed before the movement. After the movement. And I like to do them before. There is no set rule on that. You can a little bit base it off of severity. Hey, Jess.
Good afternoon.
You know, if this is drop shoulder painful, like, for example, Trev's impingement, I probably wouldn't have him cranking into a shoulder mobility pattern. What's more important is that if you get a positive on the clearing test, you just know that when you're assessing what their shoulder mobility is like. So again, taking Trev for example, any mobility he has here, I'm taking with a pinch of salt because I know that he has some impingement problems. Yeah, good question though. What's our top priority? Again, we've got ones in rotator stability, one in trunk stability, right? So we know that core function is compromised in this person. What else? My next point of emphasis is probably the shoulder mobility, which, like I said, doesn't show up, thanks, Jess. Even though it says threes, she's hypermobile and has impingement. So we may refer that out. And what are we going to do for our corrective strategy? Thanks. What's our first sort of port of call for our corrective strategy? Don't be shy, guys. Just have a think about it. What do you want to throw in there?
In regards to the focus on the
let's
exercise.
Let's start super high level. Do we want to focus on mobility or stability?
Stability of the shoulder.
Yep, stability of the shoulder. It's probably where I'd start. Right, because we know that SM and ASLR are our top priority patterns, and we have a problem in one of them. And it's a slightly complicated problem because she scored a 3-3, but it's still a problem there. And we can address that. And you probably just want to think about what strategy you're using and take a more cautious approach, because this person's in the presence of pain, you know, not going to move with authenticity. But yes, we want some scapular stability work as part of our corrective strategy. What else? Come on, guys. You need to be up on this. Have we got any asymmetrical ones? No.
Nope.
What's our next worst things? Both of these. So what's going into our corrective strategy? You guys will run out of time if you're this slow on Monday. Well, sorry, on Tuesday. You'll run out of time in the exam. A lot of questions like this, giving you hypotheticals that you need to run through and be able to address with corrective strategies. What are we thinking? Just as an umbrella strategy, what are we working on here? Core stability,
yeah.
Right? Both sagittal and transverse plane. Yeah, this is kind of a sagittal plane test, and this is transverse and frontal and sagittal. It's kind of dynamic like that. But you know, that's mainly thought of as a transverse plane test. Yeah, cool. So what are some potential corrective exercises that we could give this girl? You know, you just kind of pick two or three, right? You'd kind of one or two per pattern, and then think of the most effective ones that you could send her away with for a hip program, or work into your warm up, things like that.
Breathing be on for?
Breathing's one for everything.
Yep.
Excellent point. And going along with breathing, what else happens before we program exercise?
Removing
noxious stimuli, yeah, absolutely. Particularly probably for this, right? This kind of stuff. shoulders in particular are a problem for most people because of some sort of postural problem they have throughout their day.
Yeah.
So removing nauseous stimuli might be as simple as just readjusting height desk or getting a better chair or getting a better, more ergonomic keyboard or something like that for a lot of people. Getting a bit stronger helps a lot too. Quite often that'll clear up just from doing some simple push-ups, which I gave it away. Push-ups would be a great corrective for this person, right? Or maybe starting with a plank. You want to think big bang for buck. And a plank or any sort of prone hold is going to give you sagittal plane core stability, and it's also an excellent shoulder stability or scapular stability strategy as well. Does that make sense? Same thing with quadruped stuff. Quadruped unloads the shoulders a little bit, so you could also take that lean. These are just things that you could try. You know, so that initial core work that we spoke about of having someone in quadruped working on cervical stuff, working on scapular stuff, and then working on neutral pelvis positioning, that's a really good drill for this person. Going back up here, if you wanted to explore this further, you know, usually you do that more so if these scores were low, but if you wanted to explore this further, what would you do? Ooh, guys. There's a whole bunch of breakouts for shoulder mobility. All right, what were some of the first breakouts that we went over to? Yep.
Whatever that's called, that.
AC compression test? Yep. Just like this. What else?
Grip strength.
Grip strength, absolutely. Yep, down low and up top.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of the most severe one. Like, that's the one that you'll get the least positive returns on. Like, you know, and they're the ones that you definitely refer out.
Yeah.
Someone that's got nerve impingement, you don't want to be messing around with
yeah.
them. Yeah, so that's a really good one.
Cervical flexion extension.
Flexion extension rotation patterns, yeah. Yeah, and what are our functional, dysfunctional cutoffs there? What are we looking for when we test cervical flexion extension rotation? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that's definitely a cool thing to look at. But there's specific cutoffs for what we deem dysfunctional and functional when it comes to those three breakouts.
It might be the shoulder.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, plumb with the clavicle is for rotation. Yeah, for flexion.
Chin to
chest.
Right.
Yeah, with the mouth closed.
Yeah.
And extension. Within 10 degrees of parallel, the plane of your face being within 10 degrees or parallel with the ceiling or floor or whatever. Yeah, cool. Now this is good. I'm glad we're going over this stuff, because you guys would be failing right now.
And obviously you'd be looking for, you'd be asking continuously through that for pain.
Absolutely, yeah.
Pinching.
Yeah. And a lot of correctives you use, you'll be testing the pattern that you're working on continually through a workout. Don't think of this as just a pure, like, I run all seven patterns as part of a monthly assessment thing. You run a single pattern pretty much every time you perform a corrective to see whether you've gotten any gain out of that, right? That'd be the best way to address it. Because a lot of times, particularly if there's a motor control component, you will be able to make almost immediate change. And that's really encouraging for your trainee, and also gives you a heads up. Yes, this is the correct way to go, or no, I should try a different corrective strategy. Yeah. Okay, so what are some core exercises we could do? We've identified that sagittal and transverse planes are poor. Particularly poor here, right? If we're putting her on a bench, because the shoulder girdle strength's not there to do a push-up on the floor, and there's still a whole bunch of lumbar collapse when she does a push-up, then that demonstrates even less core stability. So this is obviously a big problem for this female. So what are we doing?
regress again and go to like a wall push up or something?
Yeah, you could. No, no, I'm not talking about for the screen. I'm talking about for your creative strategies. Yeah, that's what you would do. Yeah, potentially. Although at this point, she can do the push up, so you don't need to regress the screen any further. She's just collapsing here, so that's just a poor score. Yeah. Now, what are we doing for actual strategies?
Off the plank, can they?
Yep.
Would you feed the...
How would you feed... You could. How would you feed a dysfunction here?
Like resistance band, waiting, or... how would you do that? Because it's going to be pulling down, which is a problem.
Might be too challenging in this pattern.
Yeah.
It's a great initial thought process, though. Like... R&T, like I've told you guys, is one of your best strategies in correctives. So yeah, you can always think like, hey, could I add an R&T? And if you can, generally do. It's tough though, particularly for these last two, it's kind of tough. I wouldn't usually use it for the TSPU. I would use it potentially for the RS though. Yeah, like if someone's rotating a whole bunch in their kickback, you could feed that and have that give them more feedback so that they can pull themselves back down. You understand that in a kickback position, like if you're a quadruped and you're kicking back, there's kind of three things that can go wrong. You've got that sagittal stuff, that bowing of the back. You've got the opening of the hip, right? Kind of like this, which a whole lot of people will do. That's that hip opening up this way. And then you've got this sidling. Right, so you've got both sagittal, like this, you've got transverse, which is that, and then you've got frontal plane, which is that dipping to one side. So like I said, awesome screen to give you a look at every component of core stability. So if you're going to do R&T for an RS pattern, what would you do? You can MacGyver this stuff, guys. Like R&T is very MacGyver. Like just think of what you would do.
Head off, Chris.
No. Not for an R&T.
You could put it around the hips.
I love that corrective though. I'd absolutely do that corrective. Remember what R&T is? That's feeding a dysfunction in the pattern that you've screened.
Like so around their hips and then pull up on it?
Yeah.
So they have to push back down.
Yeah, absolutely. Right, so Dani's saying, put a band around this hip, probably just on the one leg I would.
Yeah.
And you'd be feeding it from over there, pulling her this way. And her job would be to take that feedback and pull that hip back down. Or you could get down low and pull it straight that way and have her work on that hip translation, that frontal plane stuff. Yeah, tough to get to that sagittal stuff. I'm not really sure how you feed that.
I mean, if you did it on like something that's elevated, potentially you could get under them and pull down, but that's difficult.
Yeah, maybe a bit too much.
Yeah.
Cool, so that's some cool R&T stuff. Trev, pale off press, yes, absolutely. Great exercise as a corrective. Yeah. What else?
Supermans, is that what they're called? Like one hand out and opposite way. So kind of like...
Laying prone?
Yeah.
Yeah, kind of. What's that doing?
Oh, if they're doing quadruped, it's kind of like repeating...
It's just diagonal pattern, right?
Yeah.
Call that bird dog is what that's generally called, yeah.
Superman bird dog, if you want to call it.
Yeah.
You can probably do that, but again, if they struggle with that, because they obviously did, they're a one.
Yeah. What you do is you just regress that. Your first corrective for that is just a kickback.
Yeah.
So you take that the arm part out and just work on them being able to pelvic control while doing a quadruped kickback. Yeah. What else?
A little core activated dead dog.
Yes,
yeah.
Absolutely.
Hollow body blocks or something.
Yep. Yep. Now we're going. Nice. These are good ideas.
Swiss ball as well.
Absolutely. Yeah, for sure. Okay, well that was a struggle. That was really a struggle.
We got there in the end, people.
But we got there in the end. So that's what you do, right? So you've just thought, you've given me a bunch of stability challenges for scapular stability and pretty much everything core, right? Like there's just no core stability there, so we've addressed every pattern there. So you encourage, you know, a HIIT program of those exercises as well as some potential either warm up or active recovery supersets, and see how much leeway you get. and then retest the patterns. Most of the time, this RS is not a core strength thing, not a mobility thing, it's just a motor control thing. And the best way to teach it is just do a kickback and then go to a bird dog or a quadruped diagonal, and then to slowly work your way up to that linear path reach.
With the rotary stability ones, would you want to be doing more stuff like dead buds? Because they kind of replicate that pattern, because like one arm
goes
a leg.
Yeah.
Or does it really matter? You can just do like a plank.
There's not great transfer.
Yeah.
Like,
awesome.
Honestly,
yeah.
Your best corrective for an RS is to get into quadruped and be doing kickbacks and coaching them through maintaining pelvis position and lumbar position, like not letting them collapse through their lower back. Yeah. There's not a lot of sort of crazy creative stuff that pays off as well as just getting them to practice the pattern. Yeah, it's, like I said, it's usually a motor control thing. And they've gotten very used to using their lumbar spine in place of hip extension. The TSPU, we've addressed sagittal core stability. The other thing that we want to program, probably not as part of a corrective strategy, but this woman just needs to get stronger, right, generally, through the shoulder girdle. And that's maybe 90% of your female plantar. Very few females, particularly in this day and age, have enough strength, like through their upper body. Shockingly poor strength, right? Can't do a single push-up. That's horrendous. We don't tell them that, but that's shocking. Like, that's not okay. That's how you end up with shoulder impingement, winged scapula. Bad stuff. Okay, there's one avatar, the floppy female. Shall we call her? Oh, we didn't address this asymmetry, 2-3-3-2, but that's generally how it shows up. Right, like if someone's more stable on their, like this person is more stable on their right leg, I think, right? Hurdle step. No, sorry, left leg. Yeah, hurdle step. The left hurdle step, sorry, the right hurdle step being a 3, right hurdle step is stepping with the right and stabilizing on the left, right? And then it flip-flops in the lunge, because the stabilizing leg in the lunge is the one that we measure. So almost always, if you have an asymmetry, they'll flip-flop between HS and ILL. Does that make sense? That's another pattern that you'll see replicated time and time again. This guy.
Hey Doug, I just want to check if this cord's plugged in and if it's
on.
Yes, that one. If it's
it's not on though.
Okay.
Sorry.
Glad I checked it.
You guys all good for the coffee, water, anything? I don't know, cats are fine out there.
Okay. Avatar number 2. Have a look at the scores. Guy or girl? Probably.
Could we say
elderly.
Age as well?
Yeah,
it's
elderly.
Yeah,
you
can say
elderly.
Age.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Elderly.
Elderly is not going to score a 3 here.
True.
Probably. Again, we're just sort of making some really broad assumptions, right? We're dealing with someone mobility or stability challenged? Stability or mobility?
Mobility.
Yeah.
Mobility.
Yeah, mobility challenged. No question. What's our top priority here? Yeah, that should just be automatic. You know that straight away. Our top priority is an asymmetrical one, and we have that here. And what's more, we have that in a developmentally top priority pattern, right? Shoulder mobility. We know that they're not going to be able to keep their hands up overhead. They're not going to be able to get into a, what am I doing here? This sort of thing. Like this. They're not going to be able to get into that position. So we know this is going to be affecting all of this, right? That probably would have showed up there, right? But anyway, that's no longer relevant, right? That was just something I didn't delete. You guys get the idea. What else we got going on? TSPU is pretty good. SLRs, really poor. Rotary stability is it's okay. Okay, what's top priority? Yeah, both of our top priority patterns are also our top priority scores. And we know that working on those will transfer into improvements further up the chain in the more integrated movements. Yeah. So, again, what are some corrective strategies for your top priorities here? We've got the ASLR and we've got the shoulders. Yeah, sure. And again, before we forget, let's preface this by saying breathing and removing any noxious stimuli that we can.
I perform a toe touch.
Yes, you absolutely would.
Fine tune whether the ASLRs are.
Yeah, interesting. What did I say? What did I say? I said, yes, he can touch his toes.
Oh, okay. So
it's a motor control.
Motor control.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you didn't see that I'd done that, but that would absolutely be your first call here. The standard FMS scoring sheet doesn't have that in there. I've put that into ours just so that you always remember to check the toe touch. It's quite often what will happen is you'll do the screen, you'll go home and start programming, you go, oh, I didn't check the toe touch. Well, now you just don't know whether you're programmed motor control or tissue extensibility.
I've done that a lot before.
Yeah. I wasn't going to say it, but yeah, Maddie's done that a bunch.
It's annoying too. You get home, you're like, yes, I'm right, awesome program.
Yeah.
Breaks everyone, hold on.
Yeah. I can't do anything.
And you're calling your client. Can you just do a toe touch for me?
You get down there. Yeah,
can we
right.
Skype? I just want to see it. That's right. Yeah, client never came back.
Yeah. yeah, so that's in there, so that's there to remind you. Yeah, so this person can toe touch. That to you is like a gold mine. Because if someone can toe touch and they have a poor ASLR and you tell them how important the ASLR is, like that this is the foundation for every other movement that we assess and these are the fundamentals of movement. You say the ASLR is the most important, you can't do it. Let me fix that for you in 5 minutes. You show them the incredible effectiveness of a good corrective pattern, right? And what is that? What are you going to do to them?
I don't know, posterior tilts or something, or core activation.
A core engaged single leg raise. Or something like that. Yeah, you can choose anything that involved some sort of anterior core activation. Put them into a rib tuck and posteriorly tilted pelvis position. I can tell you right now, the best one is the core engaged single leg raise, but you could use anything there.
Maybe an RNT strategy as well?
Yeah, absolutely, you could use an RNT. Particularly if you suspect some hip flexion problems, if someone's not strong through their anterior hip. And you'd see that if you saw a whole bunch of butt wink in a deep squat. So, I mean, there's heaps of, we're not really getting into that depth here, but this is why there's a notes column, right? Because someone can get down into a full deep squat and score a 3, but they do it with really severe butt wink, which is that tucking under of the pelvis. That's okay. Nice. So yeah, just some of the nuance that we haven't really gotten into with these avatars, but just keep that in mind. And you'll miss things, and you'll retest to pick up on the bits and pieces that you've missed. And we'll talk about the programs that you write up, and you'll get to a point where you're really, really confident in delivering these sessions.
Yeah, I'll tell you just from personal experience, that's when the FMS really takes a new sort of dimension, and you have a new appreciation for it, when you can see patterns leading into other patterns. And even now when I screen, I'll do the first two or three, and I, depending on what I've seen there, my focus completely shifts in those next sort of three or four. Well, not completely, but there's certain...
Yeah, you just keep your eyes out for,
yeah,
for certain things that you
yeah.
suspect are going to happen.
Yeah,
definitely. Yeah, and that just comes with reps. Okay, where were we? I digress. We were talking about... I don't even know what we're talking about.
That's what you do for it.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, cool. So we fixed that. That's done. And they're like, wow, okay, I need to pay attention to this trainer because this is like nothing I've ever seen. And you've just done that with a single corrective exercise, right? It took you 5 minutes. Yep, so now there are 3-3 on there, ASLR, most probably. Okay, so that's fixed. What's next? Yep. And this, are you going to fix this in 5 minutes? Hell no. Nothing is stickier than a 1-2 shoulder. You're just not going to fix that very quickly. What are you going to do? Yeah, you're going to start cranking around with shoulder stretches. No. It's a mobility problem. But what did I say about shoulder mobility? What do you do first? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, soft tissue work. Of all of the joints of the human body, the one that responds worst to active stretching is the shoulder. It responds really well to soft tissue work. So foam rolling for the lat insertion. Remember talking about this? Ball or thumb or even better masseuse, coracoid process, trying to get in on pec minor. Those are really good strategies. That's be where I'd start. Yeah. And then you retest. What else would you start with for the shoulder? I told you a couple of two things that are crucial for the SM. One of them is soft tissue work. The other one's T-spine mobility. Yeah, we haven't actually targeted the glenohumeral joint yet. T-spine mobility. You get them down, you start cranking around. Lumbar locked extension rotation pattern. This one that I showed you. In low kneeling, like this, and like this.
Oh yeah, like that.
And you can stand here and look at the line of their shoulder girdle, and if they can get 50 degrees of rotation, they're pretty good. But if they're a 1-2 here, they're not getting 50 degrees. Probably. An assisted variety of that is really, really good. Trev, can I have you real quick? I'll be super quick.
Shoulders.
I'm super fast. just give me a shoulder. Hold up. Just stand up. Face that way. Face the screen. Give us a SM. Okay, and come the other way. Yeah. So I'm gonna target this side. Okay, so hop down into a lumbar locked, low kneeling position. Yeah, just there, cool. And I want there's two ways you can do this mobility drill. You can do it as you saw me doing it up here, or you can put them down here. And I know that his right arm into extension and internal rotation, super locked up. So I'm actually just gonna put them back here. Usually I'd do it here. Trev, I'm specifically doing it down here. Okay, so give me this arm back here. Yeah, just try to find a position where you can hold that and give me a couple of breaths, just kind of deep breaths, thinking about expanding through your rib cage and putting some of your attention into relaxing the shoulder, just letting that breath go into the shoulder and relax there. So I'm just going to come in here, and I'm just going to start assisting Trev in some rotation. So can you come up here? Just give me all of this. Give me the shoulder. There it go. Floppy. Cool. Come back down. And inhale. exhale, and relax. Is that painful, Trill?
No.
Okay. Inhale. And exhale. You see, I've got my off hand on his opposite shoulder, just supporting his scap on that side. I'm just giving him a pretty gentle assist on his T-spine through this shoulder on his right. What are you guys seeing here? Yeah, a little bit of skeptical winging. Yeah. What else?
It's getting better.
It's getting better and it's not too bad.
Range, yeah.
Right? Like, he's actually got pretty good rotation here. So as I'm doing this, I'm probably already thinking, okay, where am I going next? Because this isn't going to help. Right? This isn't locked up for Trev. I think Trev's a super vanilla case where this isn't a sort of insidious postural problem. He's got serious injury to the shoulder. His problem is his shoulder. Right? So this is potentially a bad example here. Can you hop up, Trev? Just give us another test, though. It's better, right? What you see is when you add mobility, you see that's probably like this much better. Did it feel a little bit smoother, Trev?
Yeah.
Yeah, quite a lot better.
I had to really concentrate on the first one.
Yeah. What you find is when someone's really locked up and you free them up in the SM, you might actually start to see a lot more scapular winging. Because, and this is an important little point to ponder, is when someone gets stiff for whatever reason, it quite often stems from instability. It's the body's response to having an unstable segment, and so it stiffens that area. So when I remove that stiffness, the instability shows up. Just think about that for a second, because I know that's kind of a weird thing to think about. So in the presence of instability, the body adds artificial stiffness, like adds more fibrous tissue to a joint, or adds inflammation around a joint to protect that joint because it's unstable. And if you remove some of that stiffness or swelling, quite often what you're left with is instability again. And if you leave that instability alone, stiffness will return to protect that joint. So quite often in a case like this, you're working through, Trev just added heaps of range there, it probably would have been a little less painful, and that was just with a couple of quick breathing drills and going through some lumbar locked thoracic rotation. What you might do next is work on some scapular stability, right? You've just given him the mobility back, now you need to cement it with some stability work.
That ties in with that high low threshold scenario, doesn't it? So
yeah.
More of the global muscles kind of taking in over the role of the stabilizer.
Yeah, it does, yeah. Does that make sense, guys? That's sort of going a little bit more into the art of progressing your corrective strategies. You don't need to know that stuff right now, but that's just an interesting little sidebar based off of what Trevor demonstrated, which was when he got more range, he also got a whole bunch more scapular winging, which says that we've freed up a joint, which is dysfunctional, and it's become stiff to guard against that dysfunction. Okay. So we've gone over floppy female, stiff male.
It's 3:20 already. We're gonna move on. I think that's pretty good. Everyone okay with that? Okay. I'm not doing it. So we're going to jump ahead.
Barbells.
I actually haven't yet. No, I haven't.
Okay,
cool. I will. I'll upload those tonight.
Barbell basics. My favorite thing to talk about.
My favorite thing to listen to.
Yeah. So let's start by talking about what constitutes a good squat.
Even the dogs.
Where the
dogs
is taking off?
If I ain't getting this photo,
I don't want to be associated with this.
This PA business.
This may be a good adductor stretch. You know, this could be something you do in yoga. Outside of that, I don't see a lot of utility here. What about that? Good squat. He looks like he's in pain, right? Like that's a good sign. It's not a good squat. Look how wide his feet are, right? He's right out on the base of the rack. He's a big boy, so that doesn't look really excessive for him. What do you think is going on here? Like, we can't see because we're not in the right angle, but what can you speculate about what's going on in his spine? He looks like he's in crazy hyperextension, right? Like, he's right here. Cervical extension. Horrible, right? He's like, full shrug, heavy cervical extension, rib flare. You can see it bulging here. And you can tell that he's in crazy. You think he's going full depth?
No.
A little bit of asymmetry there as well, left to right side.
Can you play that for me, Trey? Oh, hopefully you can just click it. You might have to copy and paste it. And give it a second. Sometimes they take it. I can't actually remember what this is.
It's alright, I'll watch it.
This will be interesting.
It's
not coming up.
It's on here.
It's on here.
Oh, really?
I don't know how Mac's.
Oh, that's unfortunate.
I'm not a Mac person. I don't even touch them.
Nor am I.
What are we watching?
I refuse.
I'm watching a nightmare.
Because I can't do it. I look like an idiot.
Oh, why can't we see that?
I know why. It's because we're in full screen. We're in full screen PowerPoint. We just need to come out of there. This is a bit petty, but.
Watching some very nice things.
This looks a little bit like that college football player, doesn't it? It kind of looks like what he's probably doing. You just think about the shear on his spine at where he's reversing the weight, right there. Ouch. Yeah. Okay. My eyes hurt. We've seen enough. So this is really common as well. I don't want you to, clearly this is no good, right? But what about that? Is that good?
Yep.
Is it?
Yep.
I don't know. He's got good glute development though, right? Like, you're always going to be careful not to misappropriate good glute development for lumbar extension.
Have to look at anterior tilt versus good glute development.
Yeah.
This guy's actually got decent leg development, so potentially good glutes as well.
He's got great glutes, good round. Yeah. I'll take them.
One of the ways that we measure squat depth is by the hip crease, right here, being below the knee crease. So by that measure, is he full depth? Nah, he's not full depth. I can see the front of his rib cage here, and then just some hollowing here. That part of his shirt is empty, so I'd say he's probably in a rib flare position, which isn't great. And he's also definitely in a bit of hyperextension, right? I'm being a little bit nitpicky, but I just want to make the point that bad and good photos online aren't always bad and good by biomechanically sound definitions of what makes a good exercise.
Sorry, with that one. The only problem is knee position there, being so far forward.
Yeah? Nah. No. We'll get into that. Anatoly, this is one of the strongest men of all time. What do you guys think about what he squats? You think this guy's knee angle is bad? You're talking about Plum with his front toe, right, Danny?
Yeah.
Again, we're not in the right angle, but this guy's way forward. Yeah. Yeah, that's a fallacy that we've all been fed. Pretty good, actually, this guy, in terms of his squat technique, which you'd expect, right, because he's incredibly strong. How do you guys like that?
Nothing wrong with that.
Matt doesn't like this because his toes are externally rotated, probably to 30, 35 degrees, maybe even slightly further. That's a personal preference thing, though.
Other than that, I love it, can I say.
What about that? Maybe a little bit of lumbar hyperextension, yeah. Yeah, like where your head's at. Yeah, but is it? This is an interesting thing. So I think what's actually going on here is this guy's using the Valsalva technique to fill his belly with air.
I was wearing a belt, okay. I didn't see that.
And that's a little bit different than some uncontrolled rib flare. So there's rib flare where you're soft here and you're just arching out, and there's rib flare where you've just fully expanded your rib cage and held a breath. You can see he's holding his breath. And we'll talk a bit about that in a second. She's done the same thing. He's doing the same thing. You see that? All these guys are holding their breath. And they also look really full through their midsection. You see that? It's in direct contrast to this, where you can see there's no expansion through his midsection. This guy's got a big pot belly because he's full of air.
Those two are also doing something else. A bonus points for anyone that can pick what it is that they're doing.
I can think of a few things, but let's see what you guys can come up with. See if you're thinking like that.
The three good squats we've got here. This lady, let's just filter through. That man and that man.
Neutral spine.
Yeah, you probably make a case for it. I'm thinking more that.
I agree with Dani that she's a little bit off. A
little bit, maybe.
But this
yeah.
is a pretty good squat. If I saw this squat, I'd be happy with that.
I think we're going to segue into it. More to do with the technique that they're using.
Low bar.
Yes, they're all low bar. I think that's probably what Matt's getting at.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Shoes as well. They've all got the elevated shoes.
Yeah, they do. We won't hold that against
them. We won't go into that topic.
We won't hold that against them.
Oh, no, he's...
This guy's neutral. This guy's got some
flats.
Right, another thing you can notice is they've all got really good, strong cervical retraction.
Mm-hmm.
See that? They're really pulling back in cervical retraction.
That's a good one.
Yeah. A lot of people who squat come into this really protracted neck position. And that's terrible. Anyway, that's just a little sort of side note. The devil's in the details. This is what we're all about, right? Having sort of detail and purpose to what we do as coaches, that's the stages way. To go along with that, having standardized technique, particularly in your primary lifts, is really important. So I ruffled some feathers at our current club when one of our PTs was talking about wanting to hit a certain squat PR in a certain time frame, and the problem with the goal was that it wasn't specific, right? He just said squat. He didn't say full depth squat or squat to X depth. And so if you don't do that, he hit that weight, and I said, okay, well, how was your depth? He said, yeah, well, it wasn't very good. I was like, well, did you reach your goal then? And he's like, yeah, fuck you, man. What are you doing challenging my goal? But you see what I mean? Like, if you don't have technique standards, then we can't compare goals and we can't measure goals because we don't have specificity. Yeah, that's just kind of important for getting a decent grasp on biomechanics. I don't know why it's in there, it's just an interesting little thing. You can see how I feel about squats. Some general strength training concepts. Before we get into some of these concepts, strength training is really complex. The body is really complex. These are general rules that generally apply. First things first, breathing. So for the rank novice, generally breath work should just be rhythmic and consistent, right? We just go by that general rule of during eccentric, you're on an inhale, during concentric, you're exhaling. When they're loaded through their spine, they generally aren't strong enough to be applying the kind of weight that needs a huge amount of stiffness through their midsection. So we just go with that rhythmic breathing, that's fine. Yes, on the squat, that would look like inhaling on your way down, and then exhaling as you come out. For an intermediate lifter, that's no longer fully beneficial. That's not giving them the chance to really express their strength. So we use something called the Valsalva maneuver. which is technically holding a breath against a closed glottis. You don't need to know what that means, but have a read of this diagram when you're going through the slide decks to give you a nice an idea of what that looks like. So when you perform the Valsalva maneuver, essentially what you're doing is you're filling your thoracic cavity with air, and because you're made out of fluid, that adds pressure and rigidity to your midsection. And people that lift heavy do this. And people that don't lift heavy, who think they know better, say, isn't this going to cause an aneurysm, or am I going to have might I not have a stroke? The answer is no.
Doesn't it increase blood pressure though?
Yeah.
So wouldn't that potentially, if they had problems, so this is a uni thing and they were like, never do it.
Yeah.
Hence lives.
Yeah, that's why I prefaced that, because I knew you would say something about this. Because generally that's what weak people say.
Ouch.
Yeah. But no, that's not the case. The cardiovascular system can regulate that, essentially. Again, if you're dealing with a geriatric population, you're probably not at this level, unless they're incredibly well-conditioned, right? Like, if you're dealing with a strength athlete who's lifted their entire lives, and they're in their 70s, they could potentially still do this.
Subconsciously, your body does it anyway.
Does, yeah.
It can't control
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
If you're put in a hostile situation or you sleep, your body automatically will change.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah.
We can.
That's a natural thing.
Yeah. No, but it's a great point to bring up, and that's why I preface by saying, people in clinical settings who don't lift heavy weights will fairly frequently get to the idea that this is, if you could show me even anecdotal evidence of that being the case, I'd take a look at it. But there isn't any, and there's no literature to support that notion. So it's just one of those things that gets taught, and there's no literature to back it up. Yeah.
Same as the knee thing.
What's that?
Same as the bloody knee thing.
Yeah, the knee thing. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, yeah. Well, there's a little bit more to that,
yeah,
because we'll get into the mechanics of squat depth in a minute. Same as renal function. A lot of times we talk about hydration problems
breath.
That... just
blood pressure
really
through Valsalva. I found that quite interesting when I was studying it. If you know what you're looking at, right?
Grip. Sarah or Dani, could you just move that screen slightly?
Yep.
So this is another really important concept when it comes to barbell training, is how you approach the bar, both in terms of your standing posture as well as your grip on the bar. And these are some of the commonly used grips.
Chat about it.
Yeah.
A suicide grip is essentially, this is it here, it's a grip on a barbell with the thumb off of the bar. This is a really stupid thing to do, so don't do it. The hook grip is where you pin the thumb underneath your fingers. So what this guy's done, and then you'll enclose your other four digits over top of your thumb. It's got limited utility, particularly in Olympic lifts and some heavy pulling. Although that's mainly just because the grip will fail otherwise, this is still slightly dangerous. Guys will dislocate thumbs or tear some of their thenar tissues through this portion of their hand when they do this. Conventional grip is this. Bar rests on the palm. We use this in the majority of free weight lifts, and we'll get into this on the next page. TV screen's really upsetting me. Can someone just give me a slight up tilt on the camera, on the projector?
It's going down.
Yeah, no, there you go. That's good.
Nice.
Yeah, that's cool. This is tough to do without a barbell. But essentially what this looks like, if you could imagine Mitch's puny pen as a barbell, and the way I approach the bar is I put my hand on the bar like this, I then put my thumb like this, and I externally rotate like this. So you approach the bar internally rotated with your elbows facing out, and then you pull the bar down. What that does is it puts the bar in the lowest, meatiest part of your palm, and also puts you into an externally rotated position, which is beneficial for stabilizing your shoulder, turns on your lats. There's a lot of good stuff going on here. And also leads to something called irradiation, which we'll talk about in a minute. But that's essentially what it looks like. And I've spent way too long putting together some silly little graphs for you. Okay, so speaking of, phenomena of irradiation. So it's defined as a spreading and or increased strength of a response. And this takes place in our central nervous system, whereby a strong neural stimulation of one area of the body can radiate to other areas of the body and supply a somewhat systematic increase in neural drive. So this is where just literally by squeezing a bar, you can get stronger in, say, a squat or a deadlift. Really cool technique. And something that people generally don't know how to do, so we just remind them. And that particular technique of conventional setup on a barbell helps produce irradiation. So during strength training, we grip the bar hard, we screw out our feet, we press the bar into our back, try to bend the bar over our back. And these are all ways of leveraging the phenomena of irradiation. Just as an interesting aside, and this is something we'll talk about more in stage 3 specificity, if your intent is hypertrophy, leveraging the irradiation effect isn't really optimal because we might be trying to isolate a certain muscle. The radiation does the exact opposite. It tries to use everything to shift a heavy weight. Let's talk about bar path. These are some of the concepts that you use when you're coaching people through basics of strength training, right? A linear bar path is always more efficient than a non-linear bar path. I'll say that again because it's pretty important. A linear bar path is always more efficient than a non-linear bar path, except when you bench press. And that's not really true. I should change that because it's still a linear bar path. It's just an oblique bar path. Yeah. And this is because of these points, right? Deviations from a straight line require an external force to overcome the bar's inertia in the plane that it was coming from. So if you're going to move the bar forward, it takes energy to do that. If your intent is to lift the bar up and the bar moves forward or back at all, that's just sunk energy. That's energy that could have potentially gone into lifting the bar up higher or faster or with more weight. The other reason is a non-linear bar path increases the bar's moment arm by shifting the weight away from the midfoot, which is our center of mass, which again, we'll talk about in a second. Biomechanics 101, I spent 2 years studying biomechanics, and what's important about biomechanics when it comes to strength training, we'll cover just in these next couple of slides. Or pretty much just in this little cartoon here. So that's balanced and efficient, right? No energy goes into maintaining that. As the weight shifts away from the midfoot, this moment arm up here develops. And as a moment arm increases, so does the effort to maintain the bar. We should all just intuitively have a grasp on that. Particularly if we've studied biomechanics, we'll have a grasp on that. But that cartoon just kind of brings it home. Speaking of levers, very quickly, constituents of a lever system. So the fulcrum is essentially synonymous with an axis, right? Something around which something rotates. The force, in biomechanical terms, is your effort. Force arm is your leverage. Resistance is the bar's inertia or weight, and that's in direct competition with your force. And then the resistance arm is in direct competition with the force arm. Third class levers. So there's all these different classes of levers, and essentially what this gets at is where the force and the resistance are applied relative to the fulcrum. So a third class lever is where the force rests between the resistance and the fulcrum. We'll spend a little bit more time focusing on this, and it's also not hugely important, so don't get too caught up on lever systems. But I'll just chuck that in there. If you're already aware of lever systems, this can kind of act as a bit of a refresher for you. A couple of interesting things about this arrangement is that the resistance enjoys a much greater leverage arm, right? The resistance arm is much longer because third class lever looks like fulcrum, and if this is our lever, the force is here and the resistance is there. Can you guys see that? Sort of. So what that means is that the force arm is that long and the resistance arm is that long, which means that the resistance has far greater leverage than the force, which means that to overcome any given resistance, the amount of force that you have to apply is exponentially greater. It needs to be equal to the increase in leverage that the resistance enjoys. So that's interesting. The other thing is that this joint arrangement biases velocity over strength. And I can't remember when we'll get into that, but I'll explain it at some point. Does anyone know why that is? Just out of curiosity. Why a third class lever biases velocity over strength?
Pull closer here, so more, like little movement here produces
big movement at the end. Yeah, that's exactly it, yeah. That's cool. Does anyone else get what Dani just said? Anyone else understand what that means? It's okay if you don't, I don't expect you to.
What did you say? Yeah. So, because if you think about where the bicep tendon attaches.
That was actually a really lucid and concise explanation of how this works. So, that's good.
So should I stick with that one?
Stick with that one.
So, a little bit of movement here results in a lot of movement here. So, if you look at how little that's moved there, but then this moves so much more. So, you can do that very quickly. Sort of.
The important component missing there is that velocity is distance over time. So any time that it takes for this part to move is the same amount of time it took for this part to move, except that this moved over a much greater
distance,
right? So more distance over the same amount of time equals more velocity. Yeah. It's not hugely important. I just find it really interesting. So I included it in the slides. Whoa, what is going on? I appreciate that. It's not just me.
Yeah.
This is pretty much what I just kind of drew on Mitch's notebook there, is that we use the elbow a lot because it's one of the simpler joints in the body. It's just a simple hinge. So we have a lever. This red arrow denotes both the force vector and the line of pull of the bicep. This black arrow denotes the force vector of the resistance, which is the dumbbell, and the black line here denotes the lever arm of the resistance. And again, that's all compared to this system, which is a simple schematic of a third class lever, right? Fulcrum is the elbow, force is that bicep, the black square, which makes up the resistance, is that dumbbell. We'll review all of this next week, and we'll continue to talk about biomechanics. So if this is all a bit new for you, don't worry about it. Okay, so just a quick discussion, shall we? Particularly for you few who have been PTs or coached anyone through any type of exercise before, did you ever stop and think why you used an exercise? And if you did, what was your rationale for it? And I've just put in a little hint. I hope it's not because you like how it feels or because you needed to switch it up. And then also, what makes one exercise better than another?
Basically, specificity.
Functionality. I love it, yeah, absolutely. What does that mean, though?
So, I mean, there's lots of things you can do in a gym that just won't really help you out in ADL, so accuracy, daily living.
Yeah.
So you want to replicate those.
So basically,
yeah.
Almost synonymous with transferability, right? You can think of functionality as transferability. It has some transfer to something that you do in real life. Cool, that's pretty good. What else?
To address the issue.
Yep, cool. Yeah, with corrective, it's easy because you're trying to address a particular issue. What about in strength training, though? We're kind of, I know we've been talking about the FMS a long time and corrective strategies. Strength training.
Basically,
what makes something better for strength than something else?
Depends if it's translated to your sport or whatever you're doing as well.
Mm, not general strength.
Compound.
Compound, you say, versus isolated. Yeah, what is that?
Basically better bang for buck. So you get more out of let's say a squat, for example, than what you would doing a leg extension.
Why?
Greater muscle recruitment.
Yeah. And you can just lift heavier shit, right?
Yeah.
There's more muscle mass involved, so more muscle can adapt, and you can just lift heavier things if a movement's more compound. Yeah, that's a really good example. Yeah, compound versus isolated. What else? We've already talked about it today. Range of motion. Limited versus full range of motion around a joint is another way to compare exercises. Anything from Sarah, Jess, or Mitch? This is just an open forum, guys. I don't expect you to know. Just curious to start some discussion around the topic. Get your mental juices flowing. You've already lost two of the sort of low-hanging fruit, so to speak, yeah. Do you remember these, Matt?
What have we said so far?
Compound versus isolated, full range of motion.
Multiple joints,
mm-hmm.
We said?
Compound, yeah, compound versus isolated.
We've said full ROM.
Those
full crucible ROM.
Yep. I know you're just starting to go through your checklist now.
Yeah. What else we have? Definitely the two at the lower hanging fruit.
Yeah,
they
are.
I should know these anyway.
You'll know them when you see them. I think you probably subconsciously know them as well.
Yeah, that's good.
These are our criteria that we measure every exercise against. Right? And if you have something that does these really well and you want to switch it up, compare what you're switching to versus the fundamentals that do these things and ask yourself whether it's worth it. So it involves multiple joints. That kind of gets to the compound versus isolated. I spoke a little bit to this. Has a high weight bearing potential. I also said this. Uses a high degree of available range of motion. And another one is it loads the core in some way. Again, just more muscle being involved is generally a good thing. Not only for strength, but also just metabolic load, right? Like if someone has fat loss goals, a lot of the same stuff applies, like working over a great range of motion, using compound exercises and using things that load the core are gonna burn more calories and have a greater impact on their physique. Okay, anyway, so based on these criteria, we like things like squats, deadlifts, lunges, free weight pushing and pulling. Hopefully that's already what you like. If it's not, then I'll also gladly address that with you. Bilateral leg exercises is where we start. How are we doing? Yeah, okay. A few more minutes. We'll probably just get through bilateral leg exercises. Squat, deadlift, thrusters. Does everyone know what a thruster is, or a glute thruster?
Which type? There's two. Or glute
thruster. Do you know what a GHR and an NHC are?
Glute ham
raise.
That's the one? Yeah, they get honorable mention as well, although they're kind of accessories. They're very good ones. Squat. So the barbell squat lets us load heavily. It takes both the hip and knee through their full appreciable range of motion, and also puts a significant stabilizing stress on the midsection. So is this a good exercise for strength based on our exercise criteria? Yeah, maybe the best. No other movement targets hip drive quite as well as the squat, and recruits the muscles of the posterior chain to extend the hip and to move us through a vertical plane. Comes in three flavors. You've got your low bar, you've got your high bar, and you've got your front squat, and each has its unique breakdown of mechanics and has different applications when we're in the weight room. All three squat variations allow us to use the stretch reflex, which is basically our ability to use passive elastic tension to shift more weight. Just a little bit of biomechanical slang here. A closed angle at a joint refers to an acute angle. An open angle refers to an obtuse angle. And we use those two terms a lot in describing hip and knee angles in squats. Vertical and horizontal angles used to describe the back or spine. So more horizontal or more vertical. This is a good picture just to sort of show how all of these things change. And we spoke about this a little bit in the FMS. Essentially, the more upright your torso angle, the more acute your knee angle. Always. And it has to be, because to maintain your center of mass in place with this object, that must be the case. You'll notice this plumb line that's drawn in here always has the heavy thing that we're lifting balanced over the midfoot, which if I asked you what your center of mass is, you would tell me the midfoot. Yeah, that's what you'd tell me. So just have a little look at that. You can sort of see some relationships start to, you can start to tease out some relationships there. Right, like as soon as the bar gets shifted from your back onto your front, in order for you to, this subconsciously just happens, but we can also encourage it in our trainees. In order to maintain that bar position over your midfoot, you have to come more upright. And in order to come more upright, you must go into a more closed angle at the knee. And along with that, you go into a more open hip angle. These are inversely related joint angles. You can also, it's not shown here, but the dorsiflexion angle is positively related with the knee angle. The more knee flexion you see, the more dorsiflexion you see. Very interesting. So what muscles are we probably using more the high bar squat is sort of the poor man's low bar squat or front squat. It does a little bit of what each of these do, not quite as effectively. So let's just contrast low bar and front squat. What's going on in here? I don't really want to hear from you, Trev. Posterior loading. Why is that?
Squats, because of the angle where it is, also where your knee ends up, so it ends up pushing the weight back. So you're
it kind of pushes the weight back. I like where you're going with the angles though. Can you just expand on that?
Try. So because of where your knee angle
is, is it more hip or knee dominant?
Hip dominant.
Okay.
Why?
Because what muscles are being used?
No, just why would you call that more hip dominant?
Because angle is shorter, that's more, so.
Yeah, it's more closed or acute, right? And so we know that the hip is working through a greater range of motion, right? Which means that we know that the muscles around the hip have to be more active. Because they're relative to this, working through a greater range of motion. Okay, cool. Yeah, what about here? What's going on in the front squat?
More
not you two, too.
Sorry.
Right there. Jess? Mitch?
Represent this side. Come on.
What's happening in the front squat with the hip angle comparatively to the low bar squat?
So it's obtuse.
What is?
The hip angle.
It is, yeah, it's more open. Yeah. So what does that mean? You can pretty much just echo what I said in reverse. So this would be a good test if you're listening.
Or you can look at the photo and have a look at the hip angle. And you've already said the hip angle's what in the front squat?
Obtuse.
Yeah, it's more open. So what does that make the knee angle?
So the knee angle is more acute.
And so what does that mean?
More knee drive.
Yeah, it's more knee dominant, right? There's more work around the knee muscles. What are the knee muscles? Jess? Don't know. The quads. The muscles that you use to extend your knee are the quads. Yeah.
So if I wanted to do a quad dominant squat, Jess, out of those three, what am I going to pick? I want to work my quads. My quads are shit, by the way, so I do want to work them.
Yeah,
and what if I want to...
And I know you lift, Jess, or you have experience in exercise, so I bet without looking at the technical element of what we're talking about, you just know, like if you did a front squat, your quads work harder, and if you did a back squat, your glutes would work harder. Yeah. And this is going to also get better, guys. Remember that when I call you out, it's because I love you. I want to make sure that you're following along with what we're saying.
He calls me out a lot.
And we also need to make sure that we're working as a team, right? So there's no problem with being wrong. The only thing wrong is assume knowledge and skipping over things that you could learn from.
With a front squat, doesn't that load your patellar tendon quite a bit?
Yeah, it does.
Isn't that also bad for people with knee pain? I'm coming from a rehab side, and that's why I really...
Another reason why the low bar position is just generally better than anything else.
What else does it do for the higher up joint by joint approach? Let's go over the shoulder.
Which one are we talking about?
The difference between just LB and front squat, the two that we generally use.
So shoulder stability is an issue usually. So
which one?
For people
in general.
Yeah.
Is that a thing though? Like joint by joint approach, shoulder stability is problem. With it behind you.
Mm-hmm.
That's a more stable position for your rotator cuff to work in,
It asks a lot of the scapular stabilizers to be able to hold it front wraps, particularly at heavy weights.
That also has greater movement arm, because it's further away from.
For what joint?
For the glenoid, it's further out.
Yes, but only marginally, not as much as you think, because when you're in a front rack, you're not on your arm, you're not on your humerus, you're right.
Yeah, up
here. Right here, It is a slightly longer moment arm.
Only reason I make that point is because, yes, patellar tendon is one thing to look at. We have perspective of the front squat. I've always had massive issues doing a front squat because of my shoulders.
Mm-hmm.
That's been the limiting factor there. Working on them since, I'm all good now, and I've been able to front squat again, but it's definitely something to check prior to putting...
Yeah, lots of people have knee pain, and that's okay, because we usually low bar... back squat. And if they have knee pain, you might not put them in a front squat. It's a good point.
Very important too, based on their orthopedic profile. What some people just depending on their hip structure, they're just not going to be able to.
Yeah, inflammatory, right? We have a look at that.
We'll talk about that at some point. Stance and all.
We won't get into that too much, but it's a great point that Trev makes that individual anthropometry, which is the study of proportions and measurements of the human body, so particularly skeletal anthropometry, are pretty important when it comes to the squat. But we're not going to get into ways to assess those things, although it can be done. But yes, there is some leeway in terms of how you set someone up to perform a squat. Having everybody 20 to 30 degrees externally rotated with heels shoulder width apart isn't always going to be the best way to do things. But anyway, yeah, that was good. Just went through the conceptual stuff, guys. Started hopefully getting your creative juices flowing as it comes to the squat, but we'll leave it there and we'll pick that back up next week. So next week we're examining Tuesday and then immediately going into this lecture again, and we'll see how that goes. Cool. Any questions about the FMS and correctives? Because that is what you're going to get tested on.